Good evening. My name is Geoff Currie and I'm a professor in nuclear medicine at Charles Sturt University. Welcome to this special event webinar, Ask Us Anything About Nuclear Medicine. It's my pleasure to be your host for this evening's event, where we'll discuss the latest developments in nuclear medicine and molecular imaging, its potential applications and the exciting opportunities of this critically important but exciting industry in Australia. We should start with an acknowledgement of country. We acknowledge the traditional custodians of the country throughout Australia and recognise their continuing connection to land, waters and culture. We pay our respects to elders past, present and emerging and welcome any Indigenous Australians to the webinar today. I'm just going to start with a basic overview of nuclear medicines and why they're important. Each year in Australia, more than 700,000 life-saving and life-changing nuclear medicine procedures are performed. On average, every Australian will have at least two nuclear medicine procedures during their lifetime. The majority of these are diagnostic procedures, but there are some therapeutic procedures as well that we'll hear about tonight. As much as 80% of the 10,000 to 12,000 nuclear medicine doses used in Australia each week come from ANSTO at Lucas Heights. Nuclear medicine deals with the functional and molecular changes in tissues and organs associated with diseases. So it's very sensitive for early detection, for treatment planning and monitoring response to treatment for a variety of diseases throughout the body. Examples include degenerative diseases associated with different parts of the body, trauma, cancer, occlusions in the brain and heart, diseases of the kidneys and the skeleton, but many diseases or conditions are examined in every tissue and organ in the body. Australia leads the world in many advances and developments that improve diagnosis and treatment in nuclear medicine. Central to those developments are the infrastructure and capabilities of ANSTO. I want to thank all of the speakers for being involved tonight. Each speaker has a short presentation or video for you to listen to this evening, and there'll be plenty of opportunities to ask questions using the Q&A button on your screen and later in the event. So I think it's time to introduce our first speakers. To start tonight's presentation and to provide an overview of the manufacturing diagnostic nuclear medicines that we produce, I'd like to welcome from ANSTO, the OPAL Operations Manager, Jason Chakovski, and ANSTO Nuclear Medicine Operations Manager, Justine Murison.
Thank you very much, Geoff, for that. So as Geoff introduced me, my name is Jason Chakovski. I'm the Operations Manager for the OPAL Reactor. So I'll be taking you on a very short virtual tour through OPAL. And just explaining a little bit about what we do at OPAL. So what is OPAL? OPAL stands for the Open Pool Australian Light Water Reactor. We're a relatively young reactor facility, commissioned in 2006. And we're a 20 megawatt multi-purpose facility. We don't generate power. We use neutrons for three main purposes, health, science, and industry. And we're just going to start a presentation for you. Okay, so you are looking down from our operations bridge into the square service pool used for the storage of fuel and targets. And we're coming over to our circular reactor pool where the core sits and all the magic happens. So OPAL is a hardworking facility, typically operating over 300 days per year. We also have invested significantly in our reliability, which is typically over 98% reliability per year. And that's important for our customers. Being a relatively young facility, we have the most modern nuclear safety philosophy built into the design, and we rely on passive, redundant, independent, and diverse safety systems, not relying on people, external water, or electricity for safety. We're also very secure, so we use low enriched uranium fuel and targets. And at the moment, you're looking down into the reactor pool. So this is a 14-meter deep pool of light water. The reactor core consists of 16 fuel assemblies in a 4x4 configuration. And the reactor is cooled by light water, which is forced through the core there in the center. Surrounding the core is a reflector vessel filled with heavy water. And neutrons can travel much further in heavy water than they can in light water. Hence, this enables significantly more space for undertaking irradiations. The U235 in the core undergoes a chain reaction. And we're going to move now into a bit of a quick animation of how this occurs. Okay, so if we zoom right into a fuel assembly at the atomic level, we'll find billions and billions of U235 atoms. When a neutron interacts with a U235 atom, it becomes unstable and splits into two fission fragments. In the process of splitting, it releases between two and 3 additional neutrons. These neutrons then go on to interact with adjacent U235 atoms, therefore causing a chain reaction. And we control this chain reaction with control rods. Each splitting of an atom also releases energy, about 200 MeV of energy. But unlike a power reactor, that energy is a byproduct. We're only interested in the neutrons. Next slide, please. So this slide shows where our nuclear medicine is irradiated, or we call it cooked, inside our reflector vessel. OPAL uses low, medium, and high flux positions for these irradiations, where we typically cook our uranium plate type targets for the production of molybdenum-99, tellurium targets for production of iodine-131, and we also produce in our high flux positions something called lutetium-177. We also have a number of what we call rabbit facilities, where we can shoot cans into and out of the reactor for other unique and novel irradiations for health purposes. Okay, thank you. We'll pass over to Justine next.
Excellent. So my name is Justine, and my team and I receive the irradiated targets from Jason's team over at OPAL, and we process them into what we affectionately call moly. So just before I start talking about moly in detail, you're probably, I guess maybe, potentially asking why are we interested in moly 99? Well, the reason we're interested in moly 99 is because of the ability for us to widely use the technetium-99 in diagnostic nuclear medicine. And it is, however, a bit tricky to manufacture. Because it has a half-life of 6 hours, it's much more practical for us to focus our manufacturer and supply chain ability on the molybdenum-99. As you can see, it's got a 66-hour half-life. And so that means we're able to effectively manufacture it and ship it both domestically and internationally for use in subsequent generators. I have a cute little animation for you.
The manufacture of MO99 is a complex process. A single production run using 12 irradiated plates takes 26 hours and produces about 40 mils of MO99. Irradiated target plates arrive from the on-site OPAL reactor and are lowered by an overhead gantry crane into the first shielded hot cell to be dissolved. When in liquid form, a filtration process separates the MO99 from the other unwanted fission products. The MO99 is then transferred automatically to a purification cell and conditioned to achieve the correct chemical state before precise measurement and quality control testing. Double packaged in shielded containers, the MO99 is either exported internationally or sent to ANSTO's production and processing facility to be loaded into Gentech generators for local distribution.
So what you can see on the screen right now is my pride and joy. This is my manufacturing facility. It is a GMP licensed facility. We are licensed by the Therapeutic Goods Administration and the FDA in the US. And this is where we actually make our moly. So you can see our shielded hot cells on the screen. They're lead windows that you can see in orange. And it's essentially a production line with very, very minimal operator intervention. The guys use the manipulators to work on things in cell. They're very skilled, very highly trained individuals. And it's an absolute pleasure to work in this facility. I come from Big Pharma, and I've got to tell you, this is the coolest place I've ever worked. Geoff, did you have any questions?
Yep, so I was just waiting for the end of the animation there.
Yeah, it was moving a little bit slower than I was talking. Apologies for that.
No, that's okay. So we do have a couple of questions. The first couple of questions for Jason. Jason, how does the OPAL multipurpose reactor compare with other reactors around the world?
Okay, great question. So in terms of, so OPAL is formally designated as a research reactor. So that's a technical designation. We call ourselves a multi-purpose reactor facility. Historically, there's about 800 research reactors around the world that have been constructed, but most of these were constructed in the 1960s and 1970s. And they were constructed for a wide range of purposes. So testing of new, I guess, concepts and designs, materials testing for the power industry, testing of new fuels, neutron scattering research, industrial purposes, radioisotopes for health, and also for national strategic reasons as well. Most of the reactors previous to OPAL have focused on doing one or two of these things very well. OPAL is a little unique in that OPAL can do many of these things very well. Hence, we call ourselves a multi-purpose facility. And Australia had a very big part to play in being a very, very intelligent customer, in that we knew what we wanted from a strategic national perspective, and put out a tender. And what we've got now is a facility that can do wonderful things for health, for science, and for industry at a very, very high neutron flux as well. And so we have a very good neutron scattering capability, one of the best, if not the best in the world at the moment. A huge capacity for industrial reasons such as NTD silicon, and obviously a lot of capacity for production of health radioisotopes. The other benefit of OPAL is that we're a very, very young facility. And the benefit of that is that we've got the most modern nuclear safety philosophy integrated into the design. So as I mentioned before, you know, relying on passive safety systems, a lot of redundancy, diversity and independence in the design, not needing to rely on human beings or external sources of energy or water. And that makes us very safe. And OPAL is also very reliable. And so we operate a lot compared to most other facilities, up there with the best in the world. But we're also, for the last 8 years or so, we've been the most reliable research reactor in the world. So that, I guess, that's how we compare to other research reactors.
Sure. And I guess that your answer relates a little bit to one of the questions that has come in through the question and answer forum around safety, specifically around the safety associated with workers. And so obviously that automation is part of it, but there are other strategies that are employed?
Yeah, again, a wonderful thing about having a modern reactor is that as part of the design, we aim to keep doses as low as reasonably achievable. And we actually had a dose criteria set, which was 2 millisieverts per annum as a limit for all workers. We actually have found that we receive a lot less radiation than that. How does that compare? So it's equivalent to your natural background radiation, essentially. However, if you were, let's say you were working on an airplane as a routine basis, you'd probably be receiving about 7 or 8 millisieverts a year from cosmic radiation. So it's essentially background. It's very, very low. So the doses are very low. People are safe. And that's another wonderful thing about a modern facility.
Excellent. Now, in your presentation and the video, we heard about the manufacture of molybdenum-99 in OPAL. But are there a few people are curious about other radionuclides that are produced in the reactor? Do you have any insights there?
Yeah, so there's a number of isotopes we produce for health purposes in particular. So obviously molybdenum-99, as Justine talked about, for the production of technetium-99 generators, that's the workhorse. But we also have, I mentioned briefly, iodine-131 for thyroid procedures, lutetium-177, which is a radioisotope that can be used for therapeutic purposes. And it's actually undergoing clinical trials in Victoria at the moment for prostate cancer. And that can be targeted to very specific areas of the body. We produce something for pain palliation. So it's called samarium-153, which can be used for bone cancer. So pain treatment for bone cancer. Yttrium 90, we commercially known as Therospheres, which was used for liver and other tumors. Phosphorus 32 for pancreatic cancer. We also have done some irradiations of for holmium 166, which is quite new and novel as well, but that can be used for treatment of liver cancers as well. We've done some very new and novel irradiations more recently. Tobidium 161, which has got similar properties to lutetium 177 as an example. And that has the potential to treat micro metastases, so stopping the spread of cancer. And we've done some recent irradiations for scandium 47 as well, which could be a potential theranostic. There's a couple more, but they're some of the main ones.
Excellent, thanks for that. And just quickly, there was a question that asked where the targets come from. I think that generally we could say France. Is there any correction on that? I don't think
that's correct. France and some from Argentina.
Yeah, excellent. All right, well, just we're right on time there. So I think that we've got a couple of questions for Justine. The first one is with reference to the Australian Nuclear Medicine Facility, the ANSTO is supplying molybdenum to around 250 hospitals and clinics across Australia every fortnight. Does Australia ever have to import molybdenum and can we also export it? So there's two parts to that question.
Sure. So I'll take the first one as a priority. Yes, we do. We absolutely do import moly. And the reason why we do that generally is because of periods of shutdown. So we run a manufacturing facility. There are maintenance activities that we need to perform. And to do that effectively, we do need to shut down the facility at certain times. So to facilitate that, we import moly. And our colleagues over in Building 23 at the ANSTO Health Facility, they will use that imported moly to then load onto the generators before it's then sent out. The second part of your question is, do we export it? Absolutely, we do. Around about 50% of our volume at the moment is for export. And one of the things that my team and I are focused on strategically is building capacity in our manufacture so that we can leverage that and develop that even further in years to come.
Excellent. And I might add to that, if I could, that the transition from imported to locally produced during those times of maintenance, it's seamless in the clinical environment because it's planned so far in advance with the international community. The second question that I've got popped up here is, what type of waste is produced creating molybdenum and how is it managed?
So there are a couple of different waste forms that we produce. The biggest one for us in terms of handling it is the intermediate level liquid waste. And we have a technology that's available to us for that. It's called SynRock. It was invented back in the 1970s in a collaboration between ANSTO and the Australian National University. So SynRock is an abbreviation. It stands for synthetic rock. And it was designed to immobilise the products of nuclear reactions. Its design is tailored and it is specific to the type of nuclear waste that we produce. And there's a lot of work that goes into the background with the chemists that are involved in this, as well as the engineers. And it mimics the natural ability of the rocks to lock up that radioactive elements for hundreds and hundreds of millions of years. So ANSTO is currently building a SynRock treatment plant literally across the road from my manufacturing facility. So we're leveraging those side-by-side supply chain operations that we can achieve that way. And it will deliver a permanent, safe and economical means for treating the byproducts of the nuclear medicine and the manufacturing process that we engage with. And that will enable Australia to demonstrate its technology on an international scale as well.
Excellent. Thanks for that. And there was another question around a similar question about radioactive waste that I think Rod handled offline. But there's been some good news in the last 24 hours associated with the construction and funding of the National Radioactive Waste Repository. So there's a big project that's involved there as well. Okay, so that's the end of the questions for Jason and Justine. We might move on to introducing Professor Dale Bailey now. Again, we're right on time, 7:24. Professor Dale Bailey is the next speaker. Professor Bailey is one of Australia's leading medical physicists. He's the principal medical physicist at Royal North Shore Hospital in Sydney in the Department of Nuclear Medicine. He's also the professor of medical physics at the University of Sydney in the Faculty of Medicine and Health. Dale is also the director of Sydney Vital Translational Cancer Research Centre. So we thank Dale for his time tonight.
Good to see you, Geoff, and everyone.
Thanks. So I think we're going to jump straight into some questions, and then you've got a little slide for us to have a look at as well. So we heard about technetium-99m being manufactured via molybdenum and generators. How it's typically administered to patients is something that we haven't covered. So could you give us a bit of an insight into how it's administered to patients in the clinic?
Sure. Technetium-99m is the workhorse of nuclear medicine. It's been around since the 1970s in routine use, and we really do a lot of studies based on the use of technetium. So we can use the same radionuclide, but by attaching it to different radiopharmaceuticals, we can target different organs. So we can look at brain, thyroid, stomach, lungs, heart, liver, spleen, kidneys, bone, and so on and so on. So it's the smart chemistry that allows us to tag the technetium onto that, that then directs it to, for us, so we can study the function of those different organs and systems. So we don't mind how we get it into the body. The most obvious way is to give an IV injection, so intravenous injection to the bloodstream, and over time, the target organ will extract that radiopharmaceutical, and we might image it as it does that dynamically. So we look at the function over time and how quickly maybe that the organ is extracting that information or not doing so in the disease state. We might just look at what an image looks like after a couple of hours, typically with a bone scan. We might give it to you as something to drink, where we study the transit through the GI tract. We might even get you to breathe it in. And we've got an Australian invention called the Technigas generator, which makes a nanoparticle with a cage, a carbon cage containing technetium in the middle of it. And that acts just like an inert gas that we can breathe in. But when it goes into the lungs, it sticks where it goes. And with that, we're able to look at the ventilation of the lung and compare that to the blood flow in the lung to look for people who have blood clots. There are other more exotic ways, I suppose, of getting things into the body, such as into the spinal cord, and looking at the flow of the CSF, the cerebral spinal fluid, up over the brain, and when we look for things like leaks, but they're fairly rare studies. In general, most people get a small injection in the arm, which they're really not aware of, and then the targeting of the pharmaceutical sends that in a particular direction, and that's what we study.
Thanks, Dale. And so we've heard a lot about the role of technetium in diagnosing cancers, and you've just touched on some of the other applications in that answer for the previous question, but I guess that some people are asking, what specific diseases might be, common language to the general public, the diseases that they would recognise that nuclear medicine diagnoses or treats?
So going just a bit beyond technetium to some of our other traces, so I can include everything. So starting at the top, we've got some very good agents looking at early Alzheimer's disease and in response to treatment. This is now an FDA-approved treatment as of last week for Alzheimer's disease. Thyroid diseases, so thyroid cancer, thyroid overactivity, underactivity, blood clots in the lungs. A big use for us is in the blood flow in the heart, looking at areas of ischemia, so people who get chest pain when they're walk up a hill or stairs, when their blood flow is compromised, that can be detected with a simple scanning test. We do a lot of imaging of the bones because the bones are a target for cancer to spread to in a number of conditions, in particular breast, lung, and prostate cancer. Kidneys, really, you can think of just about any system at all, and we're likely to have a radiopharmaceutical that targets that. We can look at renal function and renal impairment. We can tell the difference between a renal artery that's stenosed versus a kidney that's got a block in outflow. We can look at liver function, and we do this regularly. And I'm emphasizing the term function because we're not just looking at the shape of the organ or anything like that. We're actually looking at how it's working. And that's what makes nuclear medicine quite unique.
Thanks for that. And in many cases, it's the physiological change that occurs before those structural changes that occur in other modalities. I've got a question here that that asks, and I guess that this is actually an important one because patients are often not sure about whether they're having a nuclear medicine test or something else, that if they had an MRI or a CT scan with contrast, is that providing the same information as a nuclear medicine scan?
Generally not. I mean, the radiology techniques such as CT, X-ray, MRI, even ultrasound to some extent, show us the structures, the shape of things, the presence of a tumorous deposit or something like that. And it gives us a picture of the structure, whereas what we're looking at more is the function. So I think nuclear medicine is often more like the biopsy that tells you about what's going on at the cellular level rather than the macroscopic kind of structural scan that you get with radiology. But that's not to downplay radiology. It's incredibly important, and it's the main go-to for many, many diseases. And, you know, you need to know where things are. You need to know what's changed, what shape, what conformity is different. But it's generally not that functional, whereas everything we do is very much functionally related.
Yeah, that's true. And so other than diagnosis, there's some really exciting things available in nuclear medicine for treatments. Can you provide some examples of some of the treatments that nuclear medicine provides?
Yeah, so Paul Ehrlich in the late 1800s talked about for the first time the magic bullet. And this is a term that's been around for a long time. But I really think nuclear medicine is something that utilizes that concept of the magic bullet. So if you had something that could target disease and send something to that site, send to those cells that would actually deliver some sort of a lethal payload, whether it's a chemotherapy, a poison, whether it's radiation that's delivered locally, then you can achieve a good local response. And so we treat disease, predominantly cancers, but as Geoff's alluded to in the introduction, some other things such as painful knees from osteoarthritis and things. So, but mostly cancer. And the idea there is to identify with the power of today's molecular biology, the certain signatures that the cells of that cancer have that allow us to target something particular, either on the cell's surface or internal to it, that can send our magic bullet to that. And then when the magic bullet's there, it can deliver its payload. And we use radiation to do that. We mostly use beta particles, which are electrons, which are negatively charged, that are released in a nuclear decay process. But increasingly, we're starting to use alpha particles, which were formerly, you know, not very popular in nuclear medicine because of their incredible toxicity. But today, to combine the power of specific precision molecular biology and targeting with the highly toxic alpha particle is looking like a very promising way forward.
Thanks for that. I have a couple of other questions from the Q&A. One of them I could probably answer. It's how common is this technology used in veterinary science? The answer to that is not very commonly. I've been involved in the veterinary applications a little bit for equine nuclear medicine, so imaging racehorses in particular. There's a number of sites. The original one in Australia is at Randwick Racecourse. And then Cobbity Lodge out at, or Cobbity, there's one at that's the University of Sydney facility in Sydney. Peter Chualli has one set up at Ascot over in WA. There's one in Canberra, there's one in Shepparton, and one in Melbourne that I'm aware of. In terms of small animals, dogs and cats, this technology is actually used in thyroid cancer in dogs and hypothyroidism in cats. And I know that Dale donated a triple-headed spec scanner to Max Zuber, the vet at Glazeville Veterinary Hospital. And that's the only dedicated small animal nuclear medicine facility in Australia. So it is used, but it's not very common. The next question is directed directly at Dale while he's on stage. What is the future of short-lived PET tracers? Coming from Giancarlo Pascali.
I could ask Giancarlo to answer that, couldn't I? But short-lived tracers are very, very useful in nuclear medicine. They limit the radiation dose to the patient. And the chemistry that people like Giancarlo do these days is able to attach it to most of those molecules of interest to target the processes, the physiology, and the organs that we're interested in. So that is the future. There's a big question in the background about, do you need a cyclotron to do that? A cyclotron is a big, relatively big machine that makes makes radioactive traces that emit positrons. We actually don't think you need that. So at Royal North Shore, we have a very wide-ranging practice with a lot of different radionuclides, but we can get by with mostly what's available without the use of an on-site cyclotron.
Excellent. And we might zip straight into your PowerPoint presentation now, which will just take a minute or two. And is that available?
So look, I thought just before leading into the next section, talking about theranostics, I'd try and give the audience a little bit of a picture about how cancers are managed today. And so if a patient presents with a cancer, what options do we have to treat that, and why are we looking for new things? So if we go to the next slide, if the patient's disease is relatively limited to a certain area, then surgery is the go-to. You know, if you can cut that out, you can remove 100% of the cells, 100% of the cancer, and that's the way to go, most definitely. But often we don't have that situation. We have a situation where there's a little bit more of a spread. So what's your next option? And so the next slide shows you that we've got things like directed regional treatments. So indicating here, maybe we might treat a liver by putting a catheter into the hepatic artery and delivering those Y90 SIR spheres that Jason referred to earlier to try and treat just that localized disease in a specific location. Also, there's topical treatments, and we're going to hear a little bit about the rhenium for skin lesions later on that we might apply for 30 to 60 minutes onto a lesion on the hand or the foot or the mouth or somewhere and treat that and then remove it. So that's the sort of regional or topical treatments. But once we go a bit further again, next slide, the next option we have really is radiotherapy as that comes up. And so radiotherapy delivers a very large amount of radiation in a very short period of time to specific targets. And if you've got relatively localized disease, but too big to be resected with a surgery, you could direct radiotherapy at that. You could even do a few sites. You might do 3, 4, 5 sites. But if it goes beyond that and the disease is spread further, radiotherapy is not really an option unless you're using it for some sort of palliation. Like if someone's got bone pain, you could give them some local radiotherapy, what they often refer to as spot welding, to just try and relieve the local pain. So if we've gone beyond the situation with just a couple of sites, the next slide, we're now starting to talk about our chemotherapies. And of course, there's wonderful new developments in chemotherapies way beyond the cytotoxics that we've had in the past, the poisons, the platinum-based treatments, into things like immunotherapy, which we've heard a lot about, especially related to melanoma and advanced T-cell technologies and things like that. So very, very exciting developments. Now treating the whole person, the systemic disease, no matter where it is. And then finally, what we're going to talk about next is theranostics. And theranostics is the use of imaging and therapy with a common molecule, but with different traces. So what I'm trying to show here in these yellow spots is the spread of disease throughout this patient's body that we will image with our nuclear medicine techniques. And if we can see it like this, we can say, if we see that, we can treat it. So then we change the radio label that's on this molecule to something which can deliver a therapeutic dose, either a beta radiation or an alpha radiation. And so we have the benefit of being able to visualize the targeting prior to the treatment to know whether it's going to work or not. And so this is really where we are up to now. And this is what we're very excited about in nuclear medicine. And so with that, I'll hand back to Geoff and take it on to the next session.
Thanks very much for that, Dale. We're just going to load up a video, and then we're going to talk to Leena and Nigel, who are radiochemists in biosciences at ANSTO. There has been a question that had, or a comment more than a question, that's come through talking about, you know, thyroid cancer and the usual approach to treatment being slash burn and poison, using the language of the person asking the question. And I think that this is really important, that the role of nuclear medicine, and certainly what Dale's pointed out in the last little set of slides, is that it's not about that anymore. It's really about having targeted therapies that are guided by these really good diagnostics that we're using in nuclear medicine, and as a result, getting much more targeted therapies. So that's the idea of theranostics, and that's the topic of the next video.
Theranostics refers to the use of a pair of radioactive agents, one for therapy and another chemically similar agent for diagnosis. Theranostics can achieve three things that traditional radiotherapeutics cannot. Firstly, it allows clinicians to scan a patient before treatment to determine if they are suitable. Secondly, it allows monitoring of the therapy throughout the treatment. Theranostics can even give clinicians the ability to determine the correct dose for effective and safe therapy.
There's tremendous interest at the moment in the nuclear medicine field in the area of theranostics. And one of the subsets where there's particular interest is in radioimmunotherapy. So that's the combination of immunotherapy, which utilizes antibodies to specifically target cells like cancer cells, in combination with radioisotopes that can do damage and kill cancer cells. ANSTO has been developing experience in the field of radioimmuno-oncology over the last couple of years. One of the key projects has been a collaboration with a company based in Sydney called Monomic International. In 2018, we successfully completed a clinical trial in collaboration with Monomic that developed and delivered a gallium-67 labeled antibody to their clinical trial, all from early development all the way through to supply. Following the positive outcomes from the Milgar trial and the observation of no adverse events, Monomic made the decision to divest a part of their business into a new company called Glytherix to focus specifically on developing new treatment products. Recently, Glytherix, ANSTO, and a number of other partners across Australia were successful in being awarded a major CRCP grant to fund the next generation of products being developed by Glytherix. One of the key outcomes from the CRCP project will be the establishment of an end-to-end pipeline for the development of radioimmuno-oncology products here in Australia. In addition to the project with Glytherix and the other partners as part of the CRCP, ANSTO is working to develop new technologies in the radioimmuno-oncology space to be able to produce better antibodies, improve the radio labelling, and deliver better health outcomes to Australians.
So Leena and Nigel will zip over to you guys for some questions now. The first question is a simple one. Do theranostics need more than one injection?
Thanks, Geoff. The simple answer is yes. So theranostics by their nature is, both Leena and Dale spoke about, you've got a imaging agent, so a diagnostic agent as well as a therapeutic. And one of the great advances that are starting to come out in this space is being able to try and understand just things like discordance in disease in patients. So we can use multiple imaging agents to determine what some characteristics about the disease that these patients have, and try and focus at their treatments to make sure that the patients are getting the best possible treatments they can to, in case of curing cancer. If we look a little bit at the therapeutic side of things, generally, there's a lot of injections there that are made up as part of the treatment cycle. So there may be several injections or infusions that are part of those treatment cycles.
Thanks for that. And I guess that Dale touched on it a little bit, but can you give us a little bit more detail on how theranostics change the way we treat patients? Sorry, just a change in headset. Can you hear me? Are you right?
Sorry, Geoff. Yeah, all good. Sorry, just to change headsets there for a second.
No, that's all right. There's a question about how theranostics change the way we treat patients.
So again, I think this is something that, that Dale touched on just briefly in his terrific slides, is that theranostics gives us the ability to be able to see an individual patient's disease. So if a patient has an avidity for a particular type of treatment, it also tells us when patients don't have an avidity to a particular type of treatment. So we don't go, when a team is planning the treatment for that patient, they don't put them on unnecessary treatments, whether they be non-radioactive chemotherapeutic treatments or immuno-oncology treatments, or even radiotherapeutic treatments. So it's tailoring the best outcomes for those patients.
Thanks. And I've got a question from Meredith online that asks, what's the shelf life of a therapeutic radioisotope dose? So I guess that there's two aspects of this. One's the half-life and the other is actually how long it can be stored before it has to be used or discarded.
Yeah, so I think you know, radiopharmaceuticals is really the ultimate in, you know, just-in-time production and just-in-time delivery. As you rightly said, Geoff, you know, there's obviously the physical half-life to worry about. And one of the challenges really in therapeutics is that, you know, we have these particles being emitted as part of the radioactive decay, and that causes damage to all the other components that are in those radiopharmaceuticals going into patients. So we have to balance that as part of it as well. So we tend to add things into the radiopharmaceuticals to stabilize them, to give them the longest possible shelf life. You know, in Australia, we're fortunate to have a really amazing logistics network that we can get radiopharmaceuticals around the country very, very quickly, within 24 hours in most cases. So, you know, we can deliver really high quality products that hopefully provide the best outcomes for patients.
Excellent. And one more question, or a group of questions. What types of cancers does radioimmunotherapy theranostics target, and how does it improve outcomes over conventional therapy approaches?
Thanks, Geoff. So the first one, at the moment, there are two clinically approved radioimmuno-oncology products globally. So that's Zevalin and Bexa. They're quite old technologies developed in the 80s. They're both for non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. One of the really exciting things in the field at the moment is over the last 15, 20 years, there's been a huge growth in the immuno-oncology space. So you know, startups and pharmaceutical companies are developing all these amazing antibodies that can specifically target cancer cells or other diseases in the human body. And, you know, there are a lot of trials going on globally, you know, both looking at treatments for cancer, and that's really tacking on, as we spoke about in the video, the treatment opportunities with radioisotopes with the immunotherapy targeting. So, you know, we should see a huge growth in that field over the next couple of years, and some really delivering some blockbuster products in that space. And when it comes to understanding how this is going to improve outcomes for patients, we're really only starting to answer that question. There are a lot of trials at the moment ongoing globally that are pitching not only radioimmuno-oncology products, but more generally radiotheranostic products with conventional therapies. And they're the sort of trials that are driving this data-driven improvement in improving patient outcomes.
Thanks for that. Now, we have another video on new radionuclides. And Leena, I'm not going to let you get away without answering a question the next little bit. And so we'll watch this next video, and I'm sure we've got a few answers for you from you.
In Australia, for providing routine radiopharmaceuticals that help improve the lives of Australians every day. However, not so well known is the work we do in the background to help companies develop the next generation of radiopharmaceuticals that will benefit Australians and people worldwide into the future.
ANSTO is using its nuclear reactor OPAL to produce neutrons that irradiate a target and produce new radioisotopes. This target is then chemically digested and separated, ready to be used in emerging radiopharmaceuticals. Each radioisotope is unique in its chemical properties as well as its physical properties. And these physical and chemical properties can be exploited to create a range of radiopharmaceuticals. If we can create a greater range of tools, then we can create a greater range of radiopharmaceuticals. ANSTO is working hard to increase the range of radioisotopes for nuclear medicine. These include isotopes such as terbium-161 and scandium-47. These isotopes are all unique in their physical and chemical properties. For example, scandium-47 is unique in that it can be used both as an imaging and a therapeutic agent, while terbium-161 has the potential to treat really small cancer metastases before they take hold.
Excellent, thanks for that. So I've got a couple of questions straight up, and they're partially answered in the video. The first one is, why does ANSTO need a bigger range of radionuclides if technetium and lutetium are so versatile?
Sure, it's a great question. And yeah, a lot of the people who've spoken prior to me have touched on this. So yeah, technetium-99m and lutetium-177 are are fantastic, but the world of nuclear medicine is just beginning. So we've barely scratched the surface. While technetium-99m allows for a mode of imaging called SPECT, oftentimes our nuclear medicine physicians will also need to do something called PET, positron emission, is required then, and they'll need other isotopes like fluorine-18 or gallium-68. Even for looking at from the area of therapy, lutetium-177 is showing outstanding results, but the truth of the matter is lutetium can't do everything. So it may not have a high enough beta energy to treat things like non-melanoma skin cancer, which we'll talk about a bit later. Alternatively, we might see patients who stop responding to lutetium-177 and need something more aggressive like alphas. It is also true to be said in some patients that that tumours can return that have ultimately been treated by lutetium-177, and you might want an isotope that can take on the micrometastases like we're seeing the promise of terbium-161 shows. And all of this is really overlaid with the fact that cancers have different properties, they have different tumour volumes, they're in different locations. So we need to balance all of the physical and chemical properties against the needs of the patient. So if we have a range of isotopes that have different half-lives, decay properties, decay energies, chemical properties, modes of production, cost of production, as well as side effects, and we have all of those tools available, it's only then that we'll really get the full impact of nuclear medicine and its variety of applications.
Thanks for that. There's a couple of questions that have come in around costs, and in particular, how do we bring costs down? So obviously, when anything is new and being developed, it comes with research and development costs. And so I guess the key question is, maybe for you, Nigel, what will help bring the costs of these new products down? I think you're muted.
Sorry there, just another issue with the headset. Look, it's a great question. I'm certainly not a health economist by any means. And as you said, at the start of these development, there's always going to be a high cost burden to patients. But I think a lot of what we strive for is trying to provide not only a breadth of options that clinicians can look at, and you know, the best solutions will float to the surface as time goes on with these, but we want patients to get the best possible outcomes. If that's what we all want, right? If we have loved ones that have medical conditions and cancer in particular, that we want the best possible outcomes for them. Part of one of the projects we're running is trying to understand what it takes to actually set up an end-to-end production facilities within Australia for immuno-oncology products. Is it better to do that ourselves in Australia, or do we import product overseas? So they're questions we don't know until we start taking these products into the clinic and producing them routinely and seeing the long-term benefits out of those.
Thanks for that. There's a couple more questions, but I think I'll hold those over because they might be right up Professor Andrew Scott's alley for answering. So thanks, Leena and Nigel, for not only those little videos, but also the answers that you provided for those questions. So the next part of the presentation is talking about partnering with industry to manufacture new medicines for all Australians. And it's a pleasure to introduce Professor Andrew Scott, who's a medical specialist and scientist and the Director of Molecular Imaging and Therapy at Austin Hospital in Melbourne. He's internationally recognised for his expertise, not only in nuclear medicine, but also in cancer biology. Professor Scott has published over 395 peer-reviewed journal publications and 27 book chapters that have helped to shape the nuclear medicine landscape, not just in Australia, but globally. He's on the ANSTO board. He's the chair of the board of Cancer Trials Australia, the head of tumour targeting program at the Olivia Newton-John Cancer Research Institute in Melbourne. And before we speak to Professor Scott, here are some examples of how ANSTO is partnering with industry to deliver better health outcomes using nuclear medicines.
ANSTO's early investment in non-carrier ad lutetium 177 production at Lucas Heights has enabled the organisation to be at the forefront of a range of clinical trials in Australia. Currently, most trials are focusing on prostate cancer, and we have one trial in melanoma. For all trials, ANSTO is the supplier of lutetium to the investigator-led study. These include trials with the Peter MacCallum Cancer Centre, ANZUP Cancer Trials Group, and Melanoma and Skin Cancer Trials Group. Partnering with different trials groups and clinicians with the aim to better support health outcomes for Australian patients with serious disease.
Thanks, Andrew. I guess that before we jump into questions about the lutetium video, there's just a couple of important questions from those viewers. The first is, are these new products that we've been talking about tonight and techniques only used in trials at present, or are some of them actually used clinically?
So most of the therapeutics that have actually been described tonight, other than I-131 or Cersvis, are actually still in clinical trials. But I think we're on the cusp of having quite a number of these approved. Certainly some of the more recent data that's been generated, particularly in Australia, looking at lutetium-177-based peptides, such as in prostate cancer, are really shaping the landscape. And even in the last 2 weeks, there was international coverage of a large European US study, which showed that in prostate cancer patients, there was remarkable improvement in responses as well as outcome survival, which was also replicating the data from here in Australia. Neuroendocrine tumor patients, lutetium-based peptides are also in the US and Europe approved, not as yet here. That goes back to the whole health technology assessment and funding process within Australia, which we all engage with. Not that it's a fabulous process, but it's necessary to generate the Medicare rebates to ensure that these are available. So many have been approved, many more are coming, and we're very much engaged in the trials which are enabling this evidence to be generated.
Thanks for that. Another question, do you foresee a day when individuals will get full body scanning for a range of cancers, the ultimate preemptive medicine tool?
Well, there have been studies which actually have been conducted overseas, mainly in Japan, interestingly, looking at screening with PET, for example, whole body screening in patients that are asymptomatic, to see whether or not they could pick up cancers that weren't otherwise diagnosed. The problem with that approach is that the yield is very low. You might only get one patient in a couple of hundred who actually shows anything. And it goes to the whole way in which you screen populations for different diseases, including cancers. You really need to be a bit more specific about looking at risk factors, and where there are risk factors, then it can be justified. But as a routine approach, just in patients of a certain age, for example, it's not been shown to be sufficiently robust, or that there's a high enough prevalence to justify its use routinely at the moment.
Thanks. Now, more specifically to the lutetium video that we just saw, the footage mentioned a clinical trial at Peter MacCallum Institute in Melbourne using lutetium for advanced prostate cancers. What's involved in a clinical trial for new nuclear medicines?
Well, clinical trials are essential if we want to improve our diagnosis and therapy of disease. And also to take advantage of the innovation that can occur with discoveries, both in academia as well as in industry. So to do these trials, you need to have the workforce. So you need to have the trial nurses, the data managers, the doctors, the technologists, who are actually trained in good clinical research practice and which are aligned with the conduct of the particular study which is being undertaken at that institution. You need to have a clinical protocol. You need to have approval from a human research ethics committee. And then, of course, you need to have access to the diagnostic and therapeutic radiopharmaceuticals, which can either be provided to the site or can be produced at the site. And I think the other important component is to have an approach to clinical trials which is embedded within the institution. And most major institutions do clinical trials routinely. But in nuclear medicine, we've been able to innovate to have a trials network called ARTNET, the Australian Radiopharmaceutical Trials Network, which has been in place for just over 5 years and which enables sites throughout the country to participate in clinical trials of diagnostic and therapeutic radiopharmaceuticals. And it's actually now been seen to be leading the world. the US and Europe are actually looking at how we do these studies, clinical trials in Australia, in the nuclear medicine community. So I think we've got a lot to be proud of and a lot of opportunities moving forward.
Thanks for that. Now, what is special about lutetium-177 that it can be used for a range of different types of cancers?
Yeah. So I think it's got the radiochemistry properties that facilitate its linkage via chelates to proteins, peptides, small molecules, which is quite facile and also quite stable. So when administered, it retains its binding until it gets to the target that you want it to go to before being released and have its effect. The other is that it does have a half-life and a beta emission energy, which is very well suited to therapeutic uses. So it's a combination of all those factors. Plus, we actually can get access to it here in Australia with low carrier added lutetium-177 from ANSTO, little plug there. But many countries can't get that quality and supply of lutetium-177. So in Australia, we are quite fortunate in that regard.
And so I guess that leads to the next question before we move on to the next video. And that's, what role does lutetium therapy fill in the Australian market that's not covered by other therapies?
Well, particularly in the cancer area where most of the lutetium-177 based therapeutics are utilised, we're talking about patients that have advanced or metastatic disease. So in the later stages of their cancer journey, and where many other types of treatments have been not effective or they're too toxic. What we are now seeing, though, is that success in some of these indications is so promising that it's starting to go earlier in the treatment cycle. And so there are many, many cancer types other than prostate cancer and neuroendocrine tumors, for example, where lutetium-177 based peptides, antibodies, small molecules are starting to be explored.
Excellent. Thanks for that. We load up the next video, I'll just let the people who are listening know that I can see there's a few questions that have come through, and some of them have been answered and some will hold back for the general questions at the end when we've got the entire panel available to answer the questions. Are we ready to go with the Onca Beta video?
Australia has one of the highest incident rates of non-melanoma skin cancer in the world, and it is the most common cancer diagnosed in Australia, with well over 400,000 new cases per year. ANSTO will be the manufacturing partner for Oncobeta, a German-based company.
The Oncobeta product is the first of its kind to be launched in Australia. Often the treatment for BCC and SCC is surgery. Renumacity offers an alternative therapy for Australians, which is non-invasive, painless, and personalized. When patients have concerns or difficulties with comorbidities and/or surgical intervention is not possible, Renumacity has shown to be very effective.
It's a pleasure to bring this project to Australia. It has been a long way to bring the new therapeutic things to here. We have started the project 2007 from Italy and my Italian colleagues, then ensuring the safety for the treatment peoples and for patients. We are happy that we can launch this product in Australia.
ANSTO is proud that Oncobeta selected our organisation as their manufacturing partner in Australia.
Thanks for the video. Andrew, Oncobeta is partnering with ANSTO to produce that topical therapy using rhenium-188 to treat skin disease. Can you tell us a little bit about how it works and what types of skin lesions it treats?
Sure. So this is actually an unusual treatment because it's already been approved by the TGA. So rather than us having to do these prolonged submissions, which take years and years, I have to congratulate the company and also ANSTO for partnering to have this treatment available right now, rather than needing to go through a lot more validation. So as indicated in that very nice video, this is essentially a topical treatment, which is given for non-melanomatous skin cancer. So we're talking about, basal cell carcinoma or squamous cell carcinomas of the skin. Now, if they're very small, they can be surgically removed, but sometimes they can be quite large or in a very unusual part of the body. So this treatment involves essentially using a topical application of rhenium-188 paste, which is left there for anywhere from half an hour to a couple of hours, and then removed. And the beta particles, which are emitted by the rhenium-188, then have an effect on the underlying skin cancer, but not in the deeper structures. It can be used a couple of times, depending on response, but it's a very efficient and well-tolerated topical treatment approach. So it's quite exciting, actually.
Well, thanks for that. It's just one of those, you know, innovations. That's how we have to describe most of what we're talking about is innovation to meet need. The next question that's come through is, in terms of new nuclear medicine treatments, how much research and development is there globally, and how does Australia rank in terms of innovation in that industry?
Well, I think it's really starting to pick up globally, but also in Australia as well. I mean, some of the recent statistics suggest that typical diagnostics are increasing by 5 to 10% per year globally, depending on the indication. And this is nuclear medicine as well as radiology. But therapeutics in nuclear medicine are now being estimated to increase between 25 and 30% per year. And I think that once the lutetium-177 PSMA treatment in prostate cancer alone becomes approved, that will be increasing our therapeutic activity in Australia as a minimum by at least 100%, possibly more. So I think that innovation is really picking up because of the opportunities for success. And I think in the last 5 years, there's been more innovation and new trials commenced in nuclear medicine that are industry supported in Australia than there has in the last 20 years. There's a number of very dynamic, small companies that are Australian based, which is very, very important and very exciting. So I think we have some exciting times ahead.
Thanks very much for that. So we do actually have a raft of other questions, but I think we're going to invite all the panelists back in now to go through, because some of them are targeted at different people. So we've got Dale, Nigel, Leena, Jason, Justine, and of course, Andrew. So I'll just run through a few of the questions. One of them might be for you, Leena. How important is the nuclear radiopharmacy? You know, how do we promote nuclear pharmacy in terms of education and training, I guess, to recruit more people into that environment?
Thanks, Geoff. I guess that really is a good question. Historically, we didn't educate directly in this field, and a lot of the people that Nigel and I work with have a background, say, in chemistry, and then we make the shift, or they might have a background in physics, and then they make the shift over. But what we're seeing now is the availability of some radiopharmacy training programs that are done collaboratively with universities and industry or other partnerships, and sometimes they spend a bit of time at ANSTO with us to see how isotopes are produced or how radiochemistry is done. But and I think some of them might be at your hospital, is that right, Dale?
That's right, yep.
Okay, thanks for that. And so another question relates a little bit to the innovation discussion that we just had. It's a bit of a chicken and an egg question. What usually comes first, the nuclear product or the idea for its use?
Well, the idea for its use, I mean, clearly, but then you have to have the innovation and the scientific know-how and the people and the skill to be able to create the molecule that targets that particular process or therapeutic approach. So you have to have good ideas. You need to have smart people. And the smart people are usually the young people. So we need more bright young people coming into the profession, no question at all.
And of course, I think Dale was talking to some students last week about some of the older tracers that we accidentally discovered. They innovated for one use and found another home that's been used more modern.
Nigel referred to that a little bit in one of his talks there. That the work he's done with Monomic in Sydney, where they came to me, they had their idea, as Andrew's alluded to, they were going to label it with an isotope X. And I said to them, I don't think that's going to work really well, but I think if you put isotope Y on, it would work better. They went back to Nigel. 2 weeks later, he'd done it. And then we've got the trial, and it's the first one that's used that old radionuclide, but in a new application to be published.
Excellent. I've got another question that talks about, well, the importance of the focus of the discussion around cancer being justified, but to talk maybe about the status of developments in neurological and cardiac diseases.
Oh, I mean, again, it's an area where nuclear medicine really has incredible opportunities. And I think that in neurology, for example, there's been an awful lot of work looking at traces to identify the presence of beta amyloid or tau in various types of dementias, particularly Alzheimer's disease. But I think one of the really pivotal things which happened actually earlier this month is that the FDA approved aducanumab, which is an anti-beta amyloid antibody for the treatment of patients with advanced Alzheimer's disease. Now, now that there's actually the very first treatment for Alzheimer's, the reason that we need to be specific in our diagnosis of Alzheimer's, particularly for beta amyloid, becomes incredibly important. So a lot of these tests, which have been very much research-based, are likely to therefore become much more mainstream in the future. And in cardiology, again, the ability to look at metabolic processes as well as vascular reserve is increasing in importance. Cardiovascular disease is one of the biggest killers in Western society and certainly in Australia. So I think nuclear medicine, again, has a very important role to continue to play in this space moving into the future. And for that, you also need technetium.
Yeah.
And Geoff, you've got good techniques in cardiac, a lot of cardiac disease, using CT, using MRI. But if you want to start to look at the neuronal control and some of those more subtle things, then they're not going to do that sort of work. You need to be able to use a radio-labeled tracer directed at that neurotransmitter system that you're interested in.
So I have a question maybe for Jason involving that we've heard about the fission that produces the molybdenum. Is lutetium produced the same way, or is it produced differently in the reactor?
Right. So there's some significant differences in terms of the target material. So the molybdenum is produced from uranium plate type targets, which are bombarded with neutrons. And one of the fission fragments that come from that is molybdenum 99, which then goes over to our ANSTO nuclear medicine facility, and it's extracted essentially. The target material for lutetium-177 is very different. It's actually a very rare material, very expensive material. But in terms of what happens in the reactor facility itself, it's a very similar process. They're both loaded into the reflector vessel and bombarded with neutrons for a period of time in very similar facilities. The lutetium-177 is cooked in a high flux facility, and the relative fluxes for let's say molybdenum 99 production is much lower. But in terms of what actually happens in the reactor, it's very similar, but they're very different target materials. And then the downstream processing is very different as well.
Thanks for that. When people are being treated with nuclear medicines, how long are you exposed to these isotopes?
Well, it depends on what isotope and what the half-life is.
Yeah.
So we introduce this into the body. Most of the time, what we introduce is eliminated either via the kidneys or via the liver into the bowel and excreted. So that has a certain time that it takes. But we've also got the physical decay of the radionuclide. So the earlier question to me about the short-lived PET traces, after about 4 hours, there's not much of those left in the body at all. But if it's something like the radioiodine, where we're looking to treat thyroid cancer, we actually want that to work over a longer period. And that has a physical half-life for iodine-131 of 8 days. And so we keep patients in because they're highly radioactive for a couple of days in the hospital after we treat them. But we then let them go once after they've eliminated a certain amount from their body. So they've concentrated the radioiodine into the thyroid cancer cells or the remnant thyroid cells that are there. And the rest of it's been excreted via the kidneys and the bladder, and then they're safe to go back into the community. So it does vary widely. Most of the time in our diagnostic tests, they are pretty much all done as outpatients. So the patient comes in the morning, will have some injection, might have a scan straight away, might wait 2 or 3 hours for a scan, and then they release back into the community. and essentially by the next day, they're back to normal levels. The therapies, of course, you want to act for longer, and so there's a little bit more of a prolonged hospitalisation sometimes. But even the peptide therapies with lutetium that Andrew Scott referred to, they are mostly performed as an outpatient procedure. So because they are small molecules are rapidly removed by the kidneys and eliminated from the body.
Thanks, Dale. I've got one here for you, Justine. Is that there's a question about the A&M facility and what it does for the extraction of molybdenum. Does it also do something with iodine-131?
Not the A&M facility.
So it is.
We are purpose-built and we are solely focused on moly. Yeah.
Excellent. So does anyone want to comment on the iodine-131 from the reactor?
I can briefly touch on it. So we have two main buildings next to the OPAL reactor. One of them is the ANSTO nuclear medicine building where Justine works. And we also have what we call our ANSTO health facility. So the tellurium targets we cook in the reactor actually go over to our ANSTO health facility. And that's a separate process altogether from what happens in A&M in terms of processing of uranium target plates. You can actually make iodine-131. It's called a fission-based iodine-131 process. So it can actually be made from uranium plate type targets as well. And you could combine the production of molybdenum-99 with that a similar process, but we don't do that process here at ANSTO. We have two different streams.
Thanks for that. A question that has come up around about the maintenance, that 300 days, what do you do for the other 65 days a year? And I probably should point out that the ANSTO reactor is actually the most efficient in terms of day use around the world. But I'm sure that Jason's got more to say about that.
Yeah, we just take a holiday, obviously. we perform all of the maintenance that we can't perform with the reactor running. We do it when the reactor is shut down. So we actually aim to do most of the maintenance that we can with the reactor running. So we aim, it's typically about an 80-20 rule on average. We also do some major capital upgrades. For any equipment that is, you know, coming to end of life, we would often upgrade it, modify systems, improve safety. A lot of these activities have to be done with the reactor shut down, but we always aim to do as much as we possibly can with the reactor running so that we can maximize uptime and maintain ourselves as getting the most return on investment for the Australian community in our asset, essentially. And so, for example, we had a major spent fuel shipment back in 2018, and we undertook the vast majority of all of that shipment with the reactor running, which took a lot of difficult planning, but we achieved it. So that's what we're always aiming to do to keep OPAL running as safely as we possibly can, but also as reliably as we possibly can.
Thanks for that. I know that these questions are sort of a little bit of a mixed bag in terms of themes, but that's how they're coming through. What's the biggest challenge in manufacturing molybdenum-99?
So we are a production facility and we are a supply chain, and we've got to overlay that with our production cycle times, but also just the natural half-life situation that we're dealing with moly. So that's our biggest challenge, is achieving that right mix and that right alignment between our batches and our production runs versus the customer orders and the demand that is required domestically and export. So lots and lots of work goes in on a continuous improvement basis, really trying to refine our cycle times. And that's where we're focused at the moment, on that agility of our production process to then cater for the half-lives in the supply chain.
Okay, thanks for that. Are the various products made at the same time in the reactor, or do they need to be produced separately?
The wonderful part about OPAL is that we can do multiple things at the same time. So we are a neutron factory. So at the same time as we are irradiating target materials for molybdenum, we're also irradiating target materials for lutetium and every other product at the same time. But we're also irradiating large crystalline silicon ingots that are used for neutron transmutation doping of silicon. So we change the semiconductor, we change them into a semiconductor device, and that's used in very high quality electronics. And we're also sending neutrons next door to the Australian Centre for Neutron Scattering, where they're undertaking research with 15 instruments. As you know, some of the best research in the world using neutron science. So the wonderful thing about OPALs, we have a big reflector vessel that surrounds the core, and that lets neutrons fly off in every direction, and they can all be used simultaneously.
Thank you. Maybe a question for Andrew and Dale. Are there any internships or programs you would recommend for high school students interested in pursuing a career in nuclear medicine? Obviously, that will depend on whether you want to become a physicist like Dale, or a physician like Andrew, or a technologist like myself. That'll be all very different, but I'll leave it open to you guys.
Not a lot that I'm aware of. I do various high school careers advisory nights, and one of the joys of doing that is to be able to explain to kids who are passionate about maths and physics in particular that you actually do something useful with it. You know, it's not just astronomy or something esoteric. So that's a really strong message that comes across when we have those interactive sessions. I've done some supervision of advanced science students from high school in New South Wales in their HSC final year. They do a project. And I had one student who did a project looking at background radiation levels in the suburb of Hunters Hill, which is famous for having had a radium smelter on the foreshore in the early turn of the 1900s. And there's still residuals from that can be measured at very, very low levels. But that was an individual approach with a student who wanted in particular to do that. But I'm not sure there's many programs set up as such. I don't know what Andrew has in Victoria.
No, I think that, you know, occasionally you get approaches from individuals who want to just spend a little bit of time just coming into the hospital, and they are able to do so in an honorary capacity, but it's not a coordinated and official process. And I have to say that I didn't know anything about nuclear medicine until after I'd actually done medicine and done a lot of my residencies before I even ventured into a department to work out what they actually did. And I thought, that's pretty cool, actually. And the rest was history. So I think you're getting a lot of exposure here. Maybe, Geoff, I'll ask you the question. What's the best way if you want to get involved from a technologist perspective? Because there are different streams and academic approaches to do that.
Yeah, the obvious answer is come to Charles Sturt University. but there's four programs in Australia, one in Adelaide at the University of South Australia, one at RMIT in Melbourne, the Charles Sturt University, one in Wagga and Port Macquarie, and then, of course, University of Newcastle in Newcastle. So that's a way in for high school students that want to do the imaging and the radiopharmacy in terms of the injection and making up the kits. But obviously, if you want to do radiochemistry, then you'd be looking at a chemistry degree and then heading off to do an internship at somewhere like ANSTO.
Geoff, I wonder if any of our ANSTO colleagues know of any programs of outreach for high school students in particular. I know that ANSTO has been running site visits, I think on Saturdays for many, many years now. I don't know if there's a more coordinated program targeting high school students.
I think Nigel had some information.
And Dale obviously mentioned some of the tours that ANSTO runs. That's a good insight, not only into the nuclear medicine aspects of what ANSTO does, but more generally. There's also the Big Ideas forum or program that runs here at ANSTO. So that's a really great opportunity. Maybe not for high school students, but for students further along in their tertiary studies, there's aspects associated with the ANSTO Innovation Campus that students can look at as well. So that's really focused on projects partnering with industry to really try and deliver radiopharmaceutical products to the clinic, but also looking more broadly at nuclear science and technology and leveraging a lot of what we do here at ANSTO.
Thanks for that. The bottom line is there's plenty of options, is that if you want to become a nuclear medicine physician, you've got to go to medical school first and you'll be exposed to a raft of professions there, and you may or may not find nuclear medicine and medical physics, become a physicist first, go and do radiochemistry or go and become a technologist. So there's plenty of options. So one of the questions is related to a family member who was going to go overseas for some of the novel treatments that maybe are not available in Australia, but COVID restricted that travel. With that sort of restriction, is there anything in Australia that would maybe expand or expedite trials to make those things available domestically?
I'd have to say that I'm not aware of any therapeutic which is available in the Netherlands, which isn't available here in a clinical trial setting. The numbers of trials and the use of both nuclear medicines as well as other therapeutics is actually very, very sophisticated here in Australia. And in prostate cancer, particularly through ANZUP, which is the Australian-New Zealand Urogenital and Prostate Cancer Trials Group, there's a huge range of clinical trials. So any major tertiary teaching hospital will have access to these types of treatments, including the lutetium 177-based PSMA studies we've talked about today.
In fact, I think, Geoff, we've had the opposite happen, that many people come to Australia for these treatments because they are available and they haven't been able to come, especially from Southeast Asia, the West Coast, the US and New Zealand in particular.
Yeah, very much so.
Yeah. So I think that we're pretty much out of time. I think we've got maybe 30 seconds to get a quick answer from Jason on what's involved in shutting the reactor down and restarting it. How long does it take? You got a 30-second one on that one?
30 seconds. I'll cut it short. We insert the control rods to shut it down and we slowly withdraw them to start it up. That's a very, very quick summary, but the whole process to start up the reactor probably takes about a day and a half in truth, with all of the startup checks that we do, safety checks, etc. But we can shut it down within less than a second.
Yeah. All right. Well, thanks. Thanks everyone for your answers there. I just aware of the time and I need to introduce Scott Martin. Tonight's event has been possible and supported by a number of scientific organisations, including ANSTO, the Australian Institute of Physics, the Royal Australian Chemical Institute, and the Royal Society of New South Wales. So on behalf of all the supporters, I'd like to thank the speakers and would also like to introduce Dr. Scott Martin, the Chair of the AIP New South Wales, to say a few words.
Thank you, Geoff, for this wonderful opportunity to voice a few words of thanks. Nuclear medicine is a wonderful example of the partnership between physics and the medical science in involving, as it does, the large-scale scientific infrastructure, production facilities, and the knowledge of the biology and chemistry of how living tissues respond. The presentations we've had tonight have given us a new insight and appreciation of the supply chain of nuclear medical products. And I particularly love the use of the word cook with the echoes of Breaking Bad coming through there. So on behalf of the AIP, the Australian Institute of Physics, ANSTO, the Royal Australian Chemical Institute, the Royal Society of New South Wales, I offer my sincere gratitude to all of our radiant speakers, Jason, Justine, Dale, Leena, Nigel, and Andrew. Thank you for illuminating the topic for us, describing the fascinating infrastructure behind the treatments that we hope we will never need, but we're so grateful for their carefully planned availability and their assured quality should we ever find ourselves in need of them. Thank you, Geoff, for your expert mastery of the ceremonies and managing to juggle every aspect of quite a complex event to perfection. And beyond thanking you all, Geoff and all of the speakers for your time tonight, I'd also like to thank you for your work. It must be enormously fulfilling to have careers that literally save lives. Thank you all for dedicating your careers towards the benefit of others. I'd like to acknowledge Rod Dowler and Fred Osman for organizing yet another inspired and inspiring annual event. It's always a pleasure to work with you both, and a joy to see the work that you put in result in such a success. Finally, Chris Olive has been our IT secret agent. Thank you for your work behind the scenes. Great result as always. Thank you very much. And with that, back to you in Wagga, Geoff.
Thanks very much, Scott. And I'd like to echo your comments and thanks to the speakers for their insights and expertise. I'd also like to thank everyone for the questions that have come through. We haven't been able to answer all of them. We will get to all of them. The ANSTO team will actually get back to all of those questions, and the recording will be available on the ANSTO YouTube site soon as well. So thanks for all of that. I'd also like to thank, Rod and the ANSTO team for putting together and opening up this dialogue, which is really important for the nuclear medicine community. And the nuclear medicine community includes all of the patients that we service. And with that, we can call the session to a close. And I hope everyone enjoys the rest of their evening.
Thank you, Geoff.
Thank you.
No worries.